I'll call the 14th regular meeting of the common council to order. Susan, would you please call the roll?
Bowman.
Here.
Deberg.
Here.
Eberg.
Here.
Serta.
Here.
Davis.
Here.
Graff.
Here.
Kittleson.
Here.
Manny.
Here.
Meyer.
Here.
Montemayor.
Here.
Radke.
Here.
Sagali.
Here.
Stefan.
Here.
Susha.
Here.
Van Akron.
Here.
And Vanderweel.
Here.
16 present.
Quorum is present. Approval of the minutes. Alderman Graff.
Thank you, Your Honor. I would move that we dispense with the reading of the minutes of the previous common council meeting and the same stand approved as entered on the record.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Under discussion? If not, all those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have the Pledge of Allegiance, and we will be led by Girl Scout Troop 354. Please come forward. And only one of you will get to use a mic, so whoever wants to use it.
Who would like to say it, you would.
Okay, we got a volunteer.
Just hold on to this, and then face the flag.
There's a flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. That was
job.
A nice Pledge of Allegiance, loud and clear, with a lot of heart. Next, we have resignations. Attorney McLean.
First is a letter from Susan Gadzinski advising that she's resigning from the Housing Committee.
I'd ask for a motion to accept.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Okay.
For appointments, the first is hereby submit the following appointments for your consideration. The Halperin Water Feature Advisory Committee, Alderman Radke, Joshua Decker, Dustin Havens, Bernard Markovich, Jay Morris, Brian Plautz, and William Wood. Alderman Radke's term expiring April 17th, and all the rest expiring April 30th, 2006, signed by the mayor.
That will lie over.
And Dustin Havens to be considered for appointment to the Housing Rehabilitation Committee to fill the unexpired term of Susan Gadzinski, whose term expires 4/30/06, also signed by the mayor.
And that will lie over.
And this was submitted at the last council meeting. Hereby submit the following appointments to the Business Improvement District for your consideration. Reappoint Linda Jarr, Cleo Messner, Janet Carter, Jane Davis Wood, and Tricia Phippen for 3-year terms to expire 9/12/08. And appoint new member Douglas Pelnar for a 3-year term to expire 9/12/08, signed by the mayor.
Ask for a motion to confirm.
So,
motion is second. All those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
The next is second for confirmation on the Tourism Advisory Committee. There's the mayor, director of planning and development, Alderperson Stefan, the Harbor Center Marina, Michael Froh, for the lodging facilities with 120 rooms or less, Kara Leonard, non-lodging tourism-related business, Linda Jarr, Harbor Center Bid, Richard Meyer, Bed and Breakfast Establishment, Frank Ribbich, lodging with more than 120 rooms, Rick Peterson, museum, Ruth Kohler, non-lodging tourism-related business, Rob Hurey, and the tourism manager as an ex officio non-voting member, signed by the mayor.
Thank you. Ask for a motion to confirm. There's a motion and a second. All those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Aye.
Motion carries. One nay. Alderman Susha.
And Thomas Holton to be reappointed as Director of Public Works and Engineering, commencing January 1, 2006, and expiring December 31, 2010, signed by the mayor.
Thank you, Attorney McLean. And I'll ask for a motion to confirm the appointment.
So moved.
There's a motion and a second. All those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Appointments are confirmed.
That's it.
Thank you, sir. Next, we have public forum. Susan?
First on the list is Sean Severson. Is Sean here?
Yes.
Sean, if you'd like to come up to the mic, and I just need your home address, please.
It's 512 Geely Avenue. I'm sorry, that's my Sheboygan address. It's 395 Sandstone Terrace in Kiel. 395
okay.
Sandstone Terrace
okay.
In Kiel.
In Kiel, okay. And you will have 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I'm a member of First Congregational United Church of Christ in Sheboygan, and I'm also one of the committee members helping to organize the youth work camp coming to Sheboygan in June of 2006. We are co-sponsoring a week-long youth work camp along with Group Work Camps Foundation, a nonprofit organization headquartered in Loveland, Colorado. Now, Group Work Camps Foundation has been co-sponsoring work camps since 1977, and every year they co-sponsor between 60 and 80 work camps along with local government agencies and private organizations. And a work camp consists of roughly 400 middle and high school youth and their adult leaders. Now, these campers pay to spend a week sleeping on the floor of a classroom or gymnasium, eating cafeteria food, working outside in some of the warmest weather of the season, and all of this is for people that they have never met. And the main work performed during the week includes porch and step repair, wheelchair ramp construction, interior and exterior painting, weatherization, light carpentry, and siding repair. Now, the recipients of these services include low-income, elderly, and handicapped homeowners. There's absolutely no cost to the homeowner for these services. All materials and services are provided for free. Now, from June 25th through July 1st of 2006, Sheboygan will get to experience such a work camp. 400 middle and high school youth from around the country, including youth from Sheboygan, will be converging on Urban Middle School. The campers will spend 5 days working on approximately 70 homes within 30 miles of Urban. They'll build new friendships and create bonds with the homeowners that they'll serve. Now, the impact of such a work camp is really simply incredible. The campers will commit more than 12,000 hours of free labor to the residents of Sheboygan. The financial impact to the community can reach in excess of $137,000, with payments going to the school district for housing and food, and to local merchants for the purchase of building materials, paint, gas, and entertainment. But the entire community is impacted by this positive project. We'll all work together to work on 60 to 80 homes for the needy. We'll create better living conditions for our neighbors, boost pride in our community, bring thousands of dollars into the local economy, provide positive peer role modeling to young people in Sheboygan, send a message of caring to the disadvantaged in our community, and help teach the adults of tomorrow the value of serving others. Now, the youth and adults of First Congregational have participated in over 10 work camps over the years, and I personally participated in 2 work camps, and I know the life-changing impact that participating in a work camp can have. And this is why First Congregational decided to co-sponsor a work camp here in Sheboygan. It's a way to serve our community and also provide a way for our youth and youth from around the country to give the gift of service. And my primary reason for being here tonight is to raise public and community awareness of this project, and second, to ask for help. We need to find 70 homes that can benefit from the services of the camp. And the types of homes that we're looking for are homes that could use the kinds of work that I outlined, the porch repair and the wheelchair ramp construction, painting and weatherization. And the targets, or the people that we're looking for, are low income, elderly, and handicapped homeowners. Now, I know that taking on this camp is a big responsibility, and it's going to be a lot of hard work for our organization and the volunteers, but I know that with the support of the community, we can make this a tremendous success. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Next would be Scott Lewandowski. Scott, can you give me your home address, please?
2201 Erie Avenue.
And you will have 5 minutes.
Okay. Mr. Mayor and members of the Common Council and Sue Richards, thank you for allowing me to speak tonight. In April 1912, a large new ship described as a floating city set out on its first voyage across the Atlantic Ocean. A few days out of port, this ship received warnings of icebergs ahead, but the captain of this ship ignored the warnings given to him from other ships and even other officers on his ship. Instead of altering the ship's course, it was full speed ahead. This ship sailed into the field of icebergs, and one iceberg in its path was seen too late. This floating city struck the iceberg, suffered major damage, took on a great deal of water, sank lower and lower, and finally sank into the depths of the ocean. The ship was a Titanic. Over 90 years later, we have another type of city receiving warnings of danger ahead, which are also being ignored. And again, it's full speed ahead into a field of danger. This time, the city is named Sheboygan. And warnings from the mayor, finance director, and even a few fellow officers, aldermen of the city, are being ignored. And instead, it's full speed ahead into another dangerous field. Not icebergs this time, but a field of debt which will sink this city unless we alter course. The majority of this common council is trying to sink this city in a sea of debt any way they can. The latest example is by adding a municipal court, which the mayor said we can't afford, the finance director said we can't afford to take the risk, and some aldermen said we can't afford it because it is projected to lose at least $65,000 or more when the city needs to be pinching pennies. According to the city clerk's report in the minutes from the last common council meeting 2 weeks ago, Sheboygan received $31,963.09 in August from the Sheboygan County Courts for not much more work than writing out the tickets. While this court can be held in the common council chambers, where do we put the staff for this court? The judge is going to need an office, and the two clerks are going to need office space and desk space, and there is no room in City Hall for this, as shown by the fact that the police department wants a new building for more room. And the city is already spending $43,980 a year to rent part of the building at 807 Center Avenue, in addition to the building it owns at 833 Center Avenue for needed office space for departments that used to be in City Hall. I ask everyone hearing me tonight, either here in person or watching on TV, to give the aldermen who voted in favor of the municipal court a call and ask them why they voted on something that will cause the city to lose money when we are in a budget crunch. Some of these same aldermen did not say one word during the discussion on the council floor before the vote was taken. Also ask them where the staff of the court will have office space and ask them about security. Will the police department have to hire an additional officer for this court, pay overtime for an off-duty officer to come in on his day off, or take an officer off the street to provide security? The aldermen who voted to sail forward full speed ahead and take on more water or debt that will sink the city deeper into the debt with the municipal court are Eldon Berg, Dennis Bauman, Gene Kittleson, Dan Berg, Bill Steffen, Don Van Akron, Gene Davis, Marge Sigali, Bonnie Serta, and Silas Vanderwille. Give them a call and see if they give you a reason or are even willing to listen to you. Many of the citizens of Sheboygan who were at Mayor Perez's listening sessions believe that many of the aldermen still are not listening, and most of these aldermen tonight will probably vote to sink the city deeper in debt by voting to build a police station in 2006 instead of waiting a year. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott. Next on the list is Dale Kolar. Dale, if you could step up to the mic, please. And I need your home address.
2004 South 25th Street.
Okay, and you have 5 minutes, sir.
Okay, I don't need that much time, okay. And I didn't prepare a speech, but what I do have is I have a problem in my neighborhood. I live within a half a block of Old Wisconsin Sausage, and they have grown in the past years, and they don't have ample parking to park the cars for their employees. So what's happening is 25th Street and parts of Union Avenue are becoming an employee parking lot. With that comes the noise at 11 o'clock at night when shifts change and engines roar, and you get loud screaming and people are relatively excited to be off of work. But you also get the garbage, the cigarette butts, the beer cans that are thrown in the back of my truck, and you get no place to park. With the winter parking regulations that are going to be coming up soon, right now they're taking up almost half the block, and with winter parking regulations, excuse me, It's feasible that they could take up one whole side of the block for the alternate parking. So I want to know if something can be done to get Old Wisconsin to provide their own parking for their employees. Secondly, the smokehouse issue, there's times throughout the summer where you can barely see across the street. The smokehouses are running virtually all day and into the night, and you can't even sit out on your patio and enjoy the fresh air. There is none. You get the residue on your windows, on your siding, on your cars. And what I'd like to see is if they could just raise the stack to a higher level to get that air to dissipate, or possibly put scrubbers in to reduce that smoke and that smell. It's really nauseating in the neighborhood. And we have a petition signed with many of the homeowners in that area that have complaints about both the parking and the smoke. So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kohler.
Alderman Bowman.
I thank you, Your Honor, for the opportunity to speak. And this is concerning the what Mr. Kohler just talked about. The problem, of course, is very real that he's stating. Since the company has done a little bit of expansion, they've hired 65 new employees, but they did not provide enough parking space for these employees to park. So in reality, what they're doing is parking up and down the neighborhood streets, not just on the street that he lives, but other neighborhood streets, and including Union Avenue. The noise, the garbage, virtually everything is a real problem also. And as he stated, there is a communication via petition that they did turn in as being distributed both to Public Protection and Safety and to Plan Commission. And hopefully these issues and, of course, the smoke thing, which was not part of it, could be handled. And thank you.
Thank you, Alderman Bowman. Susan?
Next on the list is Dan Verhasselt. Dan, can I get your home address again, please?
705 Fairway Drive.
And you will have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you for letting me speak here this evening. I'm here tonight representing the Friends of Sheboygan's Parks, and I'm here to discuss a portion of our upcoming fundraiser, which is the Great Pumpkin Festival. The Great Pumpkin Festival is a children's festival intended to raise money for the Sheridan Park equipment in the upcoming years. Over the past 5 weeks, our group, a number of dozens of our members, have been working with local businesses to secure funds, door prizes, and so on, to pull this entire event together. We've secured many games and prizes from local businesses, as I said, but we've also secured funding for the metros needed, for the music, and so on. Piggly Wiggly even stepped in and sponsoring our pie-eating contest, our pumpkin pie-eating contest. As you can see, we're working very hard and we're very serious about raising money for Sheridan Park. Tonight, I'm here to ask for the council support as well. For this event, we'll need about 20 to 25 picnic tables or straight tables or a combination thereof. But if we follow the existing protocol with the City Park Department, this is going to cost the group in the neighborhood of $300 to $400, all funds which would ultimately take away from our donations back to the city. As I said, this event is intended to raise money for the City Park system, and this event specifically is for Sheridan Park. Not all future events will be, but this one is for Sheridan Park. We feel that because of the unique design of this arrangement or potential arrangement, the city may want to consider providing these tables at no cost. I'm not asking for any special exceptions, not any special treatment, and I'm not asking for any special favors, because all of this would imply that this is some sort of event that's similar to all the others, and we're looking to cut a deal. But this event is different. Like I said, our group is pledging to donate 100% of the net proceeds back to the city in the form of park-related equipment and promotion, which I think makes it different than any festival that I've seen out there. I'm not aware of any group that donates in this order. So to me, this is a unique event. Besides, what would be the downside if 10 groups saw this tonight, if this did go ahead and decided to do the same thing? What would be the downside if 10 more groups wanted to hold an event strictly to raise money for city equipment and so on? Like I said, I'm not asking for any special favors. I just want you to treat this situation for what it is. It's a fundraiser for the city. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. And last on the list is Jeff Schuko. Jeff, could you give me your home address, please?
Yes, 2303 South 17th Street.
And you will have 5 minutes.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank the City of Sheboygan's Common Council and the Mayor for providing the citizens with this opportunity to speak. My name is Jeff Schuko of Great Lakes Avian Pest Control. I am a lifelong resident and state indentured journeyman millwright. I am here today to offer possible solutions to concerns over financial matters and health issues in our community. With service trades, jobs which generally pay less and have less benefits, replacing jobs in industry, tax reduction is no longer really a viable option if our citizens are to remain viable. Revenues need to be generated in this new service-based economy. And, well, I think we'd all agree that this service-based economy really is none of our doing. This is something that's being brought about by market conditions today and competition. Possible solutions that we could take a look at would be bring in a cruise ship with high-stakes gambling. I know this has been discussed before, but I don't believe a high-stakes gambling facility has been discussed. This would eliminate competition, as we would have the only high-stakes, high-class gambling facility, fitting for the type of clientele we would like to have at Blue Harbor. Revenues would then pay off Blue Harbor investments and offer a high-class atmosphere to our visitors. B, the revenues generated could then be used for a new police station, which I believe if we would venture into something like gambling, that would be the first thing I would want to see. With expansion of operations to provide added security and enhanced service to the citizens. And in our tourism guide, we could offer that higher security. C, pursue and develop the armory into a naval science center, which I had heard about. I believe that is a wonderful idea for that facility. It could be done in stages. For example, initially, missiles could be put on display there now. The Loki would be a wonderful one. We set up a dummy Loki in there. Sidewinders, which are used by the Navy, Sparrows, Phoenix missiles. None of these missiles are very large, and displays could be set up relatively easily. Then build a walkway across the river. Horse before the carriage sort of thing is what I was thinking there. Bringing in things to bring people here other than Blue Harbor itself. In reference to our view, the Sheboygan Press editorial, D, Great Lakes must be protected, cleaned. I believe that was in the paper August 5th. A disaster as big as any on the news is taking place right now under our noses. We are systematically destroying the greatest resource we have, water. Signs along the river saying, eat this fish once every 6 months does nothing for tourism. Beaches from Chicago to Sturgeon Bay were red flagged this summer. These beach closings were due to high E. coli bacteria counts. Two causes for this, sewage discharges after rains and gull droppings. Those are the two main contributors that I found in looking into this. We had no rain this summer. With the large numbers of gulls on our beaches, the water was left smelling and the beach sand full of droppings. This does nothing for tourism either. The beach groomer the city operates does not remove droppings from the sand. I believe it could and should be modified to do this cheaply, and I believe it can be. Keeping the migratory birds out of the parks and lakefront to acceptable numbers is now possible and more economically feasible than ever before. All the city has to do in regard to this is give me a call, and I'll take care of it. On our beaches and in our parks, our own kids are rolling around in bird droppings. The kids at Kiwanis Park playing football, we've noticed, and the sand on our beaches. From what I have learned about the avian bird virus, it's many mutations away from jumping human to human, and I think some of the hype that's out there is a bit overstated. However, it is now spreading throughout the world by migratory birds. And that's what we have problems with in our parks, mainly. The federal government should be encouraged to do us both a favor. They dredge out the Sheboygan River and do the Superfund cleanup work we were told was going to be done years ago. We put the World War II cruiser at our facility, which they're trying to get rid of right now. They're looking for a home for it.
Excuse me, Mr. Shuko, your 5 minutes are up.
Oh, okay. I have one sentence left. Thank you.
Move to open the floor. Yes. Second.
You can go back up.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Hold on. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? One no. Please continue.
Thank you. We put this World War II cruiser in our facility, which they're trying to find a home for. This ship could possibly be even fitted to be the casino. In following these steps, our tourism guide could read jet-capable airport, world-class golf, World War II cruiser museum, casino, high-stakes, high-class gambling, cleanest beaches and parks, Nassau Science Center, high-level security. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shuko.
Thank you very much. And as the council may be aware, Mr. Shuko is the one that gave endless hours to help resolve the gold problem that we had up on the south side. And we thank you for that, for the time that you gave. Okay, is that it?
That's it.
Thank you very much. Moving along, we have the mayor's comments. I'm going to make a few comments regarding two things. The second budget concerns, I'm going to not say anything on that. I'm going to wait for an issue that's coming up, an item that's coming up on the agenda. It'll be more appropriate for Mr. Gebhardt to talk to us about some of the budget concerns there. And then we'll talk a little bit about a handbook that I'm hoping put together for a committee and City Council protocol. The first item that I wanted to talk to you a little bit about is the legislative versus the executive role. And I really shouldn't say versus, because it's nothing that's competitive in nature or confrontational. It's really a synergy. One cannot exist without the other. And it's very important that I address this matter to you and with utmost respect. For some reason, there seems to be a tendency or a temptation at times to want to overreach and perhaps extend the legislative role and go to the area of micromanaging. And it is important that we recognize the role that the mayor plays as the executive and that the mayor is elected to do as the executive, and the role that this legislative body, the Common Council, is elected to do as a legislative body. The mayor is in a very unique situation, being that I play a role in the legislative function. When there's a tie, the mayor can elect to vote or not vote in the case of a tie. But the mayor, aside from being a part of this legislative body in that manner, is also the executive, meaning that I have to execute the daily managerial duties that you would expect from a city manager, perhaps, if I may say that, to compare me to a city manager. And there are things that can happen if we don't watch ourselves and we overextend ourselves. There's things that can happen that can disrupt the daily managerial duties that I have to execute. And if I don't have a feel for that structure, then it'll get me in trouble and people are going to hold me accountable for it. So that I would ask that you keep in mind that I have a role to play and you have a role to play, and I will always respect your role, and I will hope that you respect mine. Now, there's all the time we get inquiries for information and requests for information. That is perfectly all right. I encourage every one of you to continue to do that, but it's at the point where the request or the inquiry becomes perhaps a demand or a directive, then it takes a different turn, and we need to just be careful with that. If there's ever a time that you've asked for information or made a request for information or inquired about something that you weren't satisfied with the information you got, then come to me and we'll make sure we get it to you in the fullest form that you're asking. I guess what I'm saying is we need to work together as a legislative body, as an executive body, and I know that we can do that. Moving along, the budget concerns, I said, we'll be addressing. The next one is the council committee protocol handbook. There was a suggestion made at some point because of some of the manner, some of the way that some of the meetings were being handled, that perhaps we should put together a handbook that would help us work through the process of our meetings. And I mentioned this during our staff meeting today and asked if there was any staff member, department head, I should say, if there was any department head that wanted to participate in the actual construction of the handbook, if they would like to provide input. And every single one of them said, yes, we do. So it's an important issue for us. I think that people are starting to see that perhaps some of the meetings are a little too relaxed. You know, maybe we're not following the proper rules of order, the proper recognition for the chair, the proper recognition for aldermen. When aldermen are in a meeting, perhaps not a standing committee meeting, they're at another meeting, that they be addressed as aldermen, not just jumping into the conversation or discussion. There's little things like that that I think we can put into a form of a handbook that can remind us and help us, help guide us through these meetings. Susan Richards has agreed to work with me very close and keep an eye on me. And what I'd like to do, before we even hand those books out, I would like, if any alderman would like to review that also, just let me know, and I'd be glad to give you a copy in draft form if anybody would like to look at that. As I said, every department head is going to have the opportunity to review it, and so will our city attorney. Okay? Thank you very much. Moving along, we have a notice for the vacation and discontinuance of the east-west up unpaved alley located within Fairview subdivision between North 27th Street and North 27th Place. And I believe that's just a notice we have to place?
Yes. We can just accept the notice. You can ask if
there's anything. Is there a motion to accept the notice?
Second.
Second. Any discussion on that? Questions? All those in favor state aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion carries. Consent agenda. Alderman Graf.
Thank you, Your Honor. The consent agenda for 14-1 through 14-26. I would move that all ROs be accepted and placed on file, all RCs be accepted and adopted. We pass the resolutions and general ordinances.
There's a motion and a second. Under discussion? If not, would you please call the roll?
Deberg.
Aye.
Eberg.
Aye.
Serta.
Aye.
Davis.
Aye.
Graf.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stefan.
Aye.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
And Bauman.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. Report of officers 2-14-27, we will hold for 14-49. 14-28 through 14-31 lies over. 14-32 to 14-48 to be referred. Resolutions introduced, 14-49 by Alderman Montemayor, allowing the Friends of Sheboygan Parks to use various parks equipment provided by the Park Department free of charge for use at their Pumpkin Fest celebration on October 22nd. Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'll ask for a suspension of the rules on agenda number 1449.
Is there any? There's a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Aye. Does anybody want a roll call? Otherwise, there was enough ayes. Pardon me?
It requires a three-quarter vote, so I'd suggest
we'll take a roll call.
Eberg, this is to suspend. I'm
suspend the rules, right.
Yes. Eberg.
Aye.
Serta.
Aye.
Davis.
Aye.
Graf.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stefan.
Aye.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Bauman.
No.
And Deberg.
No.
14 ayes, 2 noes.
3 quarters. Motion passes. Alderman Montemayor, please continue.
I make a motion the resolution be put upon its passage, and also for agenda item number 1427, move to accept and file. I think Citizen Verhasselt explained to us.
It's under okay. There's a motion and a second.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank
under
you.
Under discussion, please.
Thank you, Your Honor. I think Dan Verhasselt explained why he would like this, why the Friends of Sheboygan Parks would like this, simply to raise money to give back to Sheboygan. So I think it would be in all of our best interest to go ahead and do this. I think it's wonderful that the group of citizens are gathering together, volunteering their time simply to raise money for Sheboygan. Thank you.
Thank you. Any further discussion? I have a light for Alderman Sigali. Did you wish to say something on this?
No, I don't have my light on.
Okay. That's okay. Alderman Vanderweel?
Thank you, Your Honor. I also think it's great that they're doing this and giving the city the money that they raise. My concern is, a few years ago, we were asked to give Habitat for Humanity a waiver on the building fees. And we were advised not to do that because you're opening the floodgates, all that sort of thing. So I would ask Attorney McLean, what is your opinion on this?
Attorney McLean?
Thank you, Your Honor. Alderman Vanderweel, it's, you know, it's not a legal issue. It's really a policy issue. So, you know, I'm not going to advise you as to whether this is something you ought to do or not. You know, if you do, I can see others making similar requests, and you'll have to deal with that. That's just, you know, I get to kind of cop out and say it's not a legal issue. It's a political issue or a policy decision.
Thank you, Attorney McLean. Alderman Sedla.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just, I have two questions, and maybe Alderman Baumann could expound on this, being chairman of Public Works. If indeed there's other entities that do something similar to this, and if we charge, and then secondly, is there a liability issue? I guess when they pay for these fees, that way they're responsible. Do they have to put down a deposit, and so on and so on?
Thank you, Alderman Baumann. Did you wish to respond to that, sir?
Well, I guess I can try. If nothing else, I notice Mr. Holton is here also, so I'll give it my best shot.
Okay. Would you rather not? We can have Mr. Holton
no,
address.
No, I'll give a little bit. Yes, when, as an example, the Kiwanis Festival is, and Bratwurst Day happens, and other events, we do lease the parks, we do lease the equipment to the entities, of course, involved. As with the JCs, yes, they do give back a great portion of the monies that they earn through community donations. As an example, the water slide was one of them, and other things that they've done for the city. And of course, other organizations also do give things back to the city. As for liability issues, I think we're going to be exempt whether we lease the equipment to them or not. But if Tom has a little better explanation, maybe he can come up with it also.
Mr. Holton, would you like to add anything to that, sir?
I guess I'd defer to Steve on a liability issue. I don't know if that'd fall under recreational immunity or not. But Alderman Baumann is right, Don. There's other groups we do charge the going rates for the rental of the park itself and equipment, and they do give a portion of what they've raised back. But I guess in this group, they're going to give 100% back to the city, which is something a little bit different than what we've had in the past.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Alderman Sarda, did that answer? Okay. Thank you. Attorney McLean?
Thank you, Your Honor. As far as liability, generally, you know, as a general legal proposition, there's less liability if you give something away than if you charge for it. Generally, you're held to a higher standard if somebody's paying for whatever it is you're providing. But that being said, as far as, you know, if someone is injured in a park during an event such as this, the city is pretty well protected under the recreational immunity statute in any event. So I don't know that there's really a liability issue one way or another that would impact this decision.
Thank you, Attorney McLean. Alderman Susha.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to bring to your attention that this council does have a history of giving things away to different groups at no charge. Just a few minutes ago, we voted on item number 1412, and what that was is we just gave away one of our free days for using Blue Harbor Conference Center, and we gave that away to the Sheboygan County Planning and Resource Department, and we're not getting anything in return for doing so. So we do have a history of giving things away, and I think that this is a worthy cause, and I would encourage the aldermen to support it. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman Susha. Alderman Eberg.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. I happened to get one call on this from somebody who was a board member of a youth group. and simply said, we're watching you. If you give this away, we've paid for every single thing, and we do good things for the city. And I think it's perhaps wise to call this question. I'm going to vote no, not because it has nothing to do with the organization. It has to do with, if we're going to have a policy to open it up to groups, I think we need a policy to open it up to groups. The policy that has stood, I think, has been a reasonable one. We get about $55,000 a year in park fees and rentals. We get about $14,000 a year from renting the armory. We get about $12,500 a year for rental of equipment. I can recall times at Public Works when people would come in, and every organization is going to find an alternate meant to be an advocate, just plain and simple. And every organization, if they're nonprofit, I think, has good cause to ask for a suspension, if you would, of fees. If we're going to do that, let's do it by policy and something that we can say we're either going to do it for all or we're going to do it on a limited basis. And until we do that, I'm going to vote no on this particular matter. Thank you.
Alderman Sagali.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. When it comes to the Blue Harbor Conference Center, is that not in the contract that we have 30 free times that we are able to rent it out and that this is what we're doing on this occasion? So we're not actually giving it away where this is something that's part of the contract?
Well, Attorney McLean can probably address it better, but my understanding is we have, I believe, 30 days for the city to use for city purposes, for city use. The extension, is that correct?
For city-sponsored events.
Or city-sponsored events, right. Does that answer your question, Alderman Sagali?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, any more discussion? Not, we're going to call the roll. Please explain the vote here.
This is to pass the resolution. An aye vote would be yes to waive the fees. Everybody okay with that? Eberg.
Nay.
Serta.
No.
Davis.
Yeah.
Graf.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemate.
Abstain, I'm sorry.
Okay. Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
No.
Stefan.
No.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
No.
Vanderweel.
No.
Bauman.
No.
Deberg. Seven ayes, eight noes, one abstention.
Motion fails. Okay, 1450 lies over. 1451 to 1453 to be referred. Report of committee 1454 to be referred. Report of committee 6, 1455 by law and licensing recommending denying taxi cab driver's license number 6908, based on the grounds of habitual criminality, failure to report all felonies, the need to preserve public safety, and his failure to cooperate with the committee. Alderman Manny.
Thank you, Your Honor. On behalf of the committee, I move that we accept the report and deny the license.
There's a motion to accept and adopt report of committee and deny license. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. Under discussion. Alderman Manny.
Thank you. Is James D. Turner here? Is James D. Turner here? Your Honor, James Turner is not here, and the committee found a clear and compelling reason to deny, including child enticement conviction, 3 second-degree sexual assault convictions related to children, and a burglary conviction. All would impinge against his appropriate use of the license.
Thank you, Alderman Manny. Any further discussion? Not, please call the roll.
Serta.
Aye.
Davis.
Aye.
Graf.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stefan.
Aye.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Bauman. Deberg.
Aye.
And Eberg.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. 1456 to 1458 to be referred. Report of Committee 7-1459 by Finance, recommending filing resolution authorizing the transfer of appropriations in the 205 budget. Alderman Groff.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd also like to do 1460, which is the RC by salary and grievance. We, the Finance Committee and the Salary and Grievance Committee, had a joint meeting at which time we took care of both of these documents, and this is a transfer of appropriations that we ultimately decided we could do this in-house, and therefore we're asking that the two RCs be accepted and placed on file.
There's a motion and a second. Under discussion, Alderman Serra.
Thank you, Your Honor. And just for the viewers at home and for the individuals in the gallery, we've just saved the city $25,000. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any further discussion? If not, all those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 1461 through 1470 to be referred. Report of Committees 8 by Finance, recommending approving the revised capital improvements program. Mm-hmm. Recommend. Pardon me?
Alderman Sagali, did you have your line?
She's going to talk on this, yeah.
Sorry.
1471 by Finance, recommending approving the revised capital improvements program recommended by the Capital Improvements Commission for the program period 206 through 210, and adopting the 206 program for the implementation with the program amended to fund the police facility at an amount of $7 million in 207 and City Hall remodeling at $3 million in 207. Alderman Groff.
Thank you, Your Honor. At this time, I'd like to make motion that the RC be accepted and adopted, and that the resolution be put upon its passage.
There's a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Under discussion.
Under discussion, Your Honor. The Finance Committee made this recommendation after their last meeting, and it was a unanimous recommendation based on the four alderpersons that were there. Alderperson Montemayor was not available. So we acted on this, and included in this is moving the police facility to 2007. Just to set the record straight, this was a change, and we brought it forward a year rather than leaving it where the Capital Improvements Commission had put it. The Capital Improvements Commission had recommended that the construction of the police facility be done in 2008. The Finance Committee moved it to 2007 and recommended that the cost be set at $7 million. We also moved the City Hall remodeling of $3 million into 2007 and asked that to be included in that borrowing. And the reason where we picked 2007 is because we know 2006 is going to be very, very tough. Presently, we have about $1 million in the building fund for the police facility, some of which we're using right now for the architect. And based on what all has to be done in 2006, it appears as though we'll be busy enough and we can use the funds that we have in 2006 to prepare for a groundbreaking early in 2007. The things that have to be done is the drawings and everything have to be prepared, the bidding on the project and everything else. And in order to avoid borrowing money in 2006, of which we'd have to pay debt service on in 2006, we thought if we could hold off until 2007 to borrow, it would help us financially. I know Rich Gephardt has some information to present regarding this same issue, but we, the Finance Committee, and I don't want to speak for all of them, but after discussing this for a good, I would guess, half hour, 45 minutes, we thought the best use of our borrowing power would be to borrow for this facility in 2007, use what we have set aside right now in 2006 to prepare to go full force in 2007.
Thank you, Alderman Groff. And we'll ask Mr. Gephardt to step up in a minute, but right now, I believe Alderman Deberg.
Well, you want to listen to him first?
Would you rather do this?
Go ahead, let him, and then I'll...
Thank you. Mr. Gephardt, would you please step up to the podium? Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. I'll refer to the memo that was placed on your desk in a summary manner. The state levy limit allows for an increase of 4.3% on the tax levy for 2006. That is with the city's current debt schedule as recommended by the Finance Committee. The budget recommendations from the standing committees would require a tax levy increase of 4.0%. The assessed values will be received from the state during the next 2 weeks and are expected to increase 2%. Therefore, the estimated tax rate increase would be approximately 2%. The levy limit can be increased for the interest payments on debt that was authorized prior to July 1st, 2005. If the council wishes to issue $7 million in bonds for the police facility construction in 2006, the tax levy would increase to 4.5%. And this is basically related, it's not as major of an impact because we anticipate talking to the architect that he would not have the design available to go to bids to mid-year, and therefore we would issue the bonds in mid-year, and we would only have 4 months of interest that we would be paying rather than 6 months. Obviously, that means in the following year, you'll have a bigger impact because you have to go to 12 months of interest, and also you have to be paying principal in 2007. And as I state, assuming a tax levy limit of 2% for operations in 2007, and with the above debt issuance and issuing $3 million in notes for City Hall remodeling in 2007, the tax levy for the 07 budget is estimated to increase 5.8%. So you get this blip, basically, that spiking of the debt in 2007 if you do issue it in 06. And that's one of the concerns that the Finance Committee has. But if the Finance Committee's recommendations are accepted, the principal and interest payments will be more level in 06, 07, and 08, and instead of having the large increase. The other area of concern with starting the project at this time, while we're under the levy restraints in 2007 and expecting to be limited to 2% for operations, is the police department, when they presented to the Capital Improvements Commission their request, they had an amount of $290,000 in there for utilities and other costs for the new facility. And with the maintenance costs of hiring maintenance personnel, I think the total is about $460,000. We realized that this would probably, I'm not really sure when it would open if we could start a construction, you know, the mid-year in 06, but we'd probably have to absorb part of that cost in 07. And that would have to be absorbed within the tax levy limit again of about 2%, which we estimate about $275,000 for the general fund. So there are some concerns about starting early. As Alderman Graf indicated, we do have funds currently available that we could, besides the design, we could be starting some site work in 06 if that was reasonable to do. Obviously, we'd have to work with the architect and with the department whether or not that is reasonable to do, and then start the actual construction early in 07. So if there's any questions.
Yes, Alderman Serta.
Thank you, Your Honor. Have you factored into this the $1 million that it's going to cost by putting off this project until 2007?
We've talked to the architect. He's looking at probably an inflationary rate that normally is around 3.5%, probably going up to about 7% as an inflationary rate. So on, you know, a $7 million project, you're probably talking about $500,000. I don't know at this point if they can be avoided even if we start in 06. You know, the energy has gone up. A lot of the situations that we fear is generally already occurring. So obviously each year there is a factor, but he said on the average in the past, on the long term, it's generally averaged about 3.5%. But occasionally you do get spikes, and this is what we're experiencing at this time.
And secondly, the state has guaranteed us the same amount of shared revenue up until 2007. What do you foresee if that declines? Can you guarantee that there'll be money enough then to wait off and put it off? Because right now we do have that same guarantee up until 2007.
Yes, you're correct. We do have it in 2007. We do not know what's ahead as far as levy limits, as far as shared revenues, which now they call municipal aid. Beyond that, we do not know who the governor is going to be. There's a lot of factors ahead. that we really do not know at this time. There's really no way of really telling what's going to come out of Madison for 08 and beyond.
Any other questions? Alderman Kittleson.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Well, I'm sorry. Did you want to go first?
Do you want to
go ahead?
Well, no.
Okay.
I'll wait.
I was following.
You'll wait. Okay.
Let me explain to you. I did not leave your light on, and that the red one went up, so we'll get you in a minute, sir. Thank you. There you go.
I guess, thank
Alderman
you, Mr.
Kittleson.
Mayor. Thank you. I just want to be crystal clear on this topic, because what I'm understanding is that we're not putting off building the police station. We are putting off borrowing the money until 2007. But we will continue to keep the process going here in 2006, as with architectural plans, with committee meetings, with agreement, and maybe even reports to the council as to how the police station is going, and then borrowing at, and what is the timeline, and early in 2007 that you will borrow this, that we will borrow this money, or don't we know?
Well, the normal pattern for construction would be to issue the debt in the first quarter of the year and start then in the spring. I think we need to clarify that, I mean, the council would have the option if they wished to issue debt and start construction mid or late 2006. Okay. Obviously, the architect has to have it designed in order for it to go out for bids. But that is an option that you would have. So you know, you're not really postponing it a full year. You're postponing it a part of a year.
So say we got going with this project, and by the end of 2006, we were ready to carry on with it. What are our options at that time? Is there anything that this council can do, a special resolution, that we can go ahead and borrow that money?
Again, we do have some funds the council has already designated that you could use for starting site work before you went for the actual construction.
So that's all.
If that was appropriate.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Alderman Eberg and then Deberg afterwards.
I would defer to the senior Alderman.
Okay. Alderman Eberg.
Thank you, Sonny. Thank you, Your Honor. Okay, now, the big thing was the site for the police station. Everybody was a group here, group there. Everybody said, okay, our biggest thing right now is let's get that site down. And the minute we got that site, we're going to start building that police station, because that's everybody's priority, was that police station. Okay, now they want to shove it off again. Now they want to delay this. If we delay this now, 207 comes along, there's going to be another project, or we're going to be short here or short there. I got a lot of calls this afternoon because a lot of people listen to WHBL because they got some pretty smart fellas there, I guess. But they told our listeners to call their older persons. And I got a lot of calls this afternoon, and they said to start in 206. Don't delay it in 207, even if it's going to cost us a little bit more. They want to get this issue done and over with once and for all. So at this time, then, I would like to amend 1471 to say that we will start on the police station in the year 2006.
Second.
Thank you.
There's a motion to amend and a second. Under discussion on the amendment only, Alderman Eberg, did you wish to discuss the amendment?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
To start the police station, I think that's a separate issue than the bonding. Am I correct? We can start the police station now. We have started it. Your amendment does not speak to moving the bonding up to 2006, which I believe, Alderman Berg, was your intent, correct?
Well, to move everything from what they're saying, 207 to 206.
Okay, that was... I'm always pleased to clarify the senior Alderman Berg's motion. Thank you,
yeah,
Carter.
I think you get senior moment.
Thank you, Alderman Eberg.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Alderman Deberg, So then your amendment will be, just so you're clear, to amend to fund the police facility at $7 million in 2006. That's your amendment, right? Okay, thank you.
Second.
Okay.
And there was a second to that. And we're still under discussion on the amendment only. Alderman Graf.
Thank you, Your Honor. Regarding the amendment, here again, we just heard from our expert, the finance director, on what we should and should not be doing. And he said it would be best, at least that's what I heard, it would be best to even out the borrowings and wait till 2007. It's not that we're putting this off a year, but we're going to start it in 2006 and work with the monies that we have appropriated. We would not borrow until 2007 if this amendment was not passed.
Thank you. Alderman Stephan.
Thank you, Your Honor. I guess just to reiterate what was said, it took us 11 months to build a fire station on land that we owned. How in God's name do we think we're going to get this thing built in 2006 is beyond me. I mean, you might get it started. I think that's a reasonable goal to get it started. But the people who think that we're delaying it for some sort of tactic, I think the normal progression leads us to at least the end of 2006 and early 2007, so why not take advantage of the borrowing? For example, at our finance meeting, again, we were working on the recommendation from the Plan Commission and capital improvements on 2008. I made a motion to move it up to 2007. Not one person seconded it, and I couldn't believe it. And then as we got more motions, well, it was because I didn't deal with the money. I don't know what $13 million is going to buy us. Now Alderman Berg says $7 million. Is that enough? Does the chief know? We've heard 17, we've heard 5 in Janesville, but that doesn't matter. We're going to make a commitment tonight to spending $7 million, and that's it? And what are we basing that on? The biggest thing I think we've got to wait on is to say, okay, here's what you get for $5 million, here's what you get for 7, here's what you get for 10, here's what you get for 13. Okay, we kind of think we pretty much solved the gun range issue now. We're working with the county and the LTC. We're kind of thinking that most of it, I think there's an agreement that the municipal court can be held here. But we still don't know what we're getting for what cost. And I can't imagine, we're locking in dollars tonight. When you put it in the 2006 capital improvements, that means that's it. If we put it in 2007 at $7 million and $3 million, we can always adjust that next year and say, you know what, that's not quite enough. We need $8 million, but maybe we only need $2 million to fix City Hall. I think that process takes us well into next year. And you know, I have no intention whatsoever. If I thought for a minute that this thing wouldn't get built, I wouldn't support it. I wouldn't support 2008 because I, exactly what he said. You know, I believe our governor is going to be Jim Doyle, but you don't know what the restrictions are going to be under. You don't know if you're going to be able to build it. In 2007, we know the rules we're under. We know the state rules. We know what our revenues are going to be. I think it's just, you know, it's going to take us that long anyways. We're arguing about a 4-month, 5-month period, and it would be foolish to say, you know, just stand firm and say we want to build it in 2006 because that's when I want to build it, even though it doesn't make any logical sense to me.
Alderman Eberg.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. I guess on the amendment, the financial model to me is relatively unclear. I think I hear some bits and pieces of it, but one of the areas that really hasn't been addressed is the cost of money now versus the cost of money a year from now. And the research that I did involved contacting a banker and a broker. They indicated that the cost of money between this year and next year would likely be between 0.5% and 1%. On $7 million, that would range between $202,000 and $404,000. So if we look at the cost of money by borrowing it now versus the cost of money in terms of borrowing it in a year, that would be the cost to us. The second cost is I had contacted a couple of builders who didn't get back to me, but I have two in-house experts, Tom Holton and Alderman Groff. Who basically used a 15% figure that they felt would be the inflationary rise in building. To some degree, that is buttressed by a conversation that I had with the broker, because as many of you know, steel has went up approximately 25%. The reality is, in the United States, we're not going to build any more steel mills. And her belief was that that will hold and be a significant factor in any new construction. When you factor in that by waiting 1 year, and again, the part of this model I wasn't aware of, where do you slice this off in 6 months? That's why I'm really leaning to kick it to the Finance Committee primarily to have this model put out in a more three-dimensional role so that you can have more data for a decision. But to the point, if we have a 10% increase in building costs on $7 million, the 10% increase next year will be about $900,000. If there's a 15% increase, $700,000. If there's a 15% increase, it will be $1,050,000. So when you roll up the numbers, if you wait from January this year, for example, until January 2007, the increase in inflationary costs of building and the potential increase of money would range from about $900,000 to $1,454,000. And I think that factor has to be put into the model that we're looking at. And I guess for me tonight, I'd like to see that. That's why I'm going to vote against the amendment, have it go to finance in the hope that you could take a look at this, and then we will have a chance to get another kick at the cat, correct? This will be coming back? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Alderman Serra.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm just dumbfounded by some of the discussion that we're having here. I think we're working backwards. I mean, let it be said, I mean, I did not pick the city hall, but I'm willing to, you know, move ahead on this issue. And I think it's about time we don't pass the buck anymore. Because guess what? There's no guarantees. Whether we want to have warm fuzzies about this issue, if we put it in writing, there's no guarantees. And we're just delaying this. And I think this community has had it up to here. They want to see it done now. And when you look at it, and I will be making an additional motion, we can borrow money for what some would perceive as a want towards $125,000 for a park improvement, and we're going to spend over close to $500,000 for our parks in 2006, but we can't even fund a necessity of our police department that I thought we were all at least on agreement for. There is no guarantees. Rich Gephardt just said that right now. You wait till 2007, there might not be the same amount of revenue from the state. What is going to be said? There might be new council members here. And we went through all this homework. It is our job. No more passing the buck.
Alderman Sagali.
Thank you, Your Honor. I guess what I'm not understanding, if I want to go to a building contractor and I want to build a new house, I tell him, I want a house for $150,000. So he's going to do the architectural work, whatever. And whatever is going to be, it's going to be $150,000. He's not going to come back to me, at least he better not, and say it's going to be higher. This is what I can work in. Now, if we say to this architect, Zimmerman, that we're going to want to build a police station for $7 million, I'm sure there is something that can be worked out that it comes with everything that they're going to need to equip this police station, and we can come up with $7 million. I guess I'm like with Alderman Serta. We're having a problem here. These officers have waited for how many years? We've gone this far, and we need to go further, and we need to build it now. We owe that to them. They have protected us and this city, and we need to do that now. Thank you.
Alderman Susha.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I guess what I want to look at is what we owe the taxpayers. There are some things that we can't really control, such as the increase in the price for gasoline that we put in our cars and the increase in the gas that we're going to use this year to heat our homes. And I do feel that as an older person, I do have some small amount of control over what we're going to slap them with in regards to their property taxes. And at this point in time, I don't feel that we have cut the budget enough to warrant a new police station. I think a step in the right direction is that we are going to be looking at the table of organization in the next few months, and hopefully early next year there will be a recommendation as to which positions on the table of organization we can eliminate. I'm not talking about laying people off. I'm talking about eliminating positions, primarily managerial positions at the top of the organizational chart where it's a little bit heavy. And if we eliminate, let's say, three positions, that would probably free up close to $300,000 in salary and benefits that we would be saving by altering the table of organization. Once we do something along those lines, I'm just using this as an example, then we will be in a much better financial position to move ahead with more borrowing
because ultimately the goal is to keep the tax rate as flat as possible. The people in the city of Sheboygan are paying a pretty high amount in their property taxes, and I think they've had enough, and I'd like to try to help them control the controllables and keep the costs down. So I'll support moving the police station up to 2007, but moving it up to 2006 isn't feasible at this time.
Alderman Maddy.
Thank you, Your Honor. My concern is along the line of where Alderman Susha is going, and that is general fund and the costs in our budget. Rich Gebhardt had suggested originally that a new police station, if we had built the full 80,000 square foot model, would cost us perhaps $460,000 in operating budget per year. How do we fund that when we have limits? I believe I'm correct when I say we will have $200,000 additional from the state in 2007 over 2006. Is that correct, Mayor?
Prox.
Correct. If that's the reality, we will incur increased operating funds in the general budget somewhere in the range, in my guesstimate, of $300,000 to $320,000 for the new police station. If we incur such funds, how do we pay for any salary increases for personnel? So what we're doing is probably building a station and laying off officers and other city employees, or perhaps redoing the table of organization. I think we need to look at this more holistically before at least I'm ready to vote. So I'm going to vote against moving it to 2006 for the amendment, but I would like this pursued in committee of the whole so we can look at all the implications and not just the capital cost implications.
Alderman Vanderweil.
Thank you, Your Honor. This question is directed to yourself, Mayor, or Alderman Graf, whoever can answer it. It's been said that in 2000, even if we leave this borrowing to 2007, that we're going to move forward, that we're going to go with the architect, have them do everything involved. What guarantee do we have that that's going to happen?
What guarantee do you have that the police station is going to happen?
That we're going to move forward, that we're going to have the architect come in, that the architect's still going to go forward, because it's going to take probably 9 months, a year, to design this. So I know that we all want this to happen, that we've already waited too long. I'm just wondering if there's a guarantee besides, if there's a guarantee written down is what I'm wondering.
Okay, I will respond to that on this, Alderman Graf.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know that any of us are in a position to guarantee any of us something, okay? We have to be very careful how we do that. But what I can do, and I think what I've done over and over and over again, is to tell everyone that I support building a police station, and it's going to get built. Some of the thoughts that are being shared with you today is that we don't move fast and foolish, but that we move thoughtful and progressively. Keep this police station in track. It's going to be built. Now, the insinuation that somebody's trying to sabotage the construction or somebody's trying to delay, it's a good fear tactic, but it doesn't work for me. I know the amount of time that I spend on that budget. Every single day we talk about that budget. And Mr. Gebhardt, that's his job. Every single day. I know the amount of time that we put into it. I trust his judgment. When he comes to me and tells me what he just told you tonight, I don't have to second guess him. But I can give you my personal word that if I have my way, and sometimes you've seen what happens when I have my way, that police station is going to get built in 07. But there's a lot of things that need to happen even now, and we have the money set aside for that so that we can continue to keep this thing in track. Nobody's trying to derail anything. Nobody's trying to delay anything. We just want to make sure we do it very thoughtfully and very progressively. And by golly, I guarantee you, that I can guarantee you, we're going to have a police station. Okay? Alderman Meyer was next. I'm sorry. Hold on, Alderman Meyer. Alderman Graf, did you want to say something, sir?
Yes. Just in response to Alderman Vanderwill. Looking at the Finance Committee, we talked about, well, would we do this and wouldn't we? And everybody on the Finance Committee said, yes, we want it to move forward. But relating to Alderman Sigali's item that she had brought up, if she wanted to build a house, she'd go and ask it. She could not have it built tomorrow. There was no way. You have to go and you have to ask them, well, design this for me, and tell me when you can start construction, because construction in the city of Sheboygan is fairly decent right now. They'll probably say, okay, we can build this for you, and we'll start the design work, but it's going to be 4 months before we can start. So you have to live with that or find a different builder if you don't like that. The same with the police station. We have John, we have Zimmerman and Associates, John Savinash, thank you, working on this. And I believe there was a meeting like 3 or 4 weeks ago where he met with you, Your Honor, and the police department and several other things, and you worked out what needed to be done and things that needed to be done. And based on the drawings that he needs to let estimates out to see what it's going to cost for this and what it's going to cost for that, he's got to build, he's got to come up with some type of a timeline so that you know this can be started here, this can be started here, and this can be started here. And that's why finance chose 2007, because they knew we had enough funds to work on all these things in 2006 to plan for an early start in 2007. And so that's why it's got to stay in 2007, because I don't think we'll be building in he won't have his designs and everything done in 2006.
Thank you. Alderman Meyer.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I know our police have to work out of this old, crummy building, but I do believe that our police do a very good job. They operate out of their cars. They are their offices. And I feel very safe in this city. I think our police department does an excellent job. And I guess it's just too bad that for 40 years we have needed a new station, and in 40 years we don't have any money saved. We are so in debt, and now we're going to throw more money onto our taxpayers? This is wrong, and I think everybody needs to sit back and think about what you're here for. You're here to represent the taxpayers, not somebody else, the taxpayers. And these are the people that have to come first. Thank you.
Alderman Eberg.
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. I think this is a fruitful discussion. And again, for me, I'm not feeling like I've got all the information. I've got, I think, technical questions. I think it would be, for me, helpful if Mr. Savinash could come and give us a timeline with some inside and outside times. And I do believe a motion to refer takes precedent over an amendment, if I'm correct, so I'm going to move to refer to Committee of the Whole.
Second.
There's a motion and a second.
I'm sorry, who seconded that?
A motion and a second to refer the matter to Committee of the Whole. Alderman Davis, sir, did you wish to say something on the... go ahead, I'll let you talk on the other issue.
Honorable Mayor, the whole intent of the Finance Committee and the discussion that went on, you know, it's pretty lengthy discussion, and we literally negotiated numbers and years. Our whole intent was to put debt service off to eliminate either zero or a very minimal amount next year. And that's hopefully that's where we're driving. I have to agree with, you know, Alderman Eldenberg there and recommend it come back and we'll look at that. I think it's Mr. Gebhardt's intention that we minimize any debt service for next year. Exactly how on paper we get that, I don't care, but I'd be fully supportive of, you know, bringing that back to the Finance Committee and take a stronger look at, you know, construction starts in the late fall, increase in inflation or whatever, and construction costs. So, but it was the intent of the Finance Committee to minimize debt service.
Thank you, Alderman Davis. And as was mentioned, there's a lot of logistics that have to be taken care of. Building Use Committee needs to meet with John Savinash, his associates. They need to meet with the police chief and the deputy chiefs and whoever else he'd like to include. Those meetings will occur. There are things that have to be discussed and looked at. There will be specific to our police department, not in generality to other police departments that have been built. There's a lot that needs to happen. Council, it's going to happen. It is happening. Let the process work. Please call the roll on the referral to Committee of the Whole.
Is it to the Committee of the Whole or to Finance?
Committee of the Whole.
Do we need a roll call, Steve, for the referral? No, you don't need one.
Just a question. If you refer it to, you don't want to refer, do a dual referral to Finance so they can take a look at it?
A dual referral, I think, would be appropriate.
Okay, let's make, would you include that
also
in your motion?
Two open Mondays coming up,
okay,
which would allow for scheduling time.
Dual referral.
Okay.
Okay, please call the roll.
Davis.
Aye.
Graff.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
No.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stefan.
Aye.
Susha.
No.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Bauman.
Aye.
Dieberg.
No.
Eberg.
Aye.
Serta.
Aye.
13 ayes, 3 noes.
Motion carries. 1472 by Alderman Grouchy. Would you say something, sir?
Yeah, I just want to ask Rich Kephart, how does this fit into our schedule as far as the budget being approved by the end of November? We'd have to have these meetings very soon, I would think.
Mr. Kephart? Correct?
Yes, I guess, you know, it'd be the question of amending the budget at the last meeting on November 28th, I guess, you know, still can be amended at that point. But I would think you would want to have, if since this is, you know, a major adjustment, you would want it to be included in the proposed budget that is going to the council in the first meeting in November, which I believe is November 7th. So it's included in the notice that is published on the budget. But it would not have, I don't think that would have to be required. I mean, you could do it at the end, but it's kind of a major adjustment to be doing at the last meeting. So I guess be the question whether or not, you know, we can have these meetings during the next couple Mondays here and try to get that in for the November 7th meeting in council.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gephardt. Okay. 1472 by Public Works, authorizing the purchasing agent to enter into contract for the demolition of the municipal incinerator. Alderman Bauman.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd move that the report of committee be accepted and adopted and that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Under discussion?
Under discussion, Your Honor, the original estimates for demolition of that former incinerator building were over $300,000. We are very, very pleased to have the amount come in at $127,900. So I think it's a very good thing.
Yes, it is. Thank you. Alderman Graff.
Thank you. You know, I know this was in capital improvements for a long, long time and was always voted down. The $127,900 is coming from Department Public Works account number 400-112-160. Tom, what is that? Or Rich, what is that?
Mr. Gephardt?
The 400 fund indicates that it is non-borrowed capital project funds. This is appropriations that the council had put in place earlier. Basically, it was a transfer from the general fund at that time.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gephardt. Okay. Please call the roll.
Graff.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stefan.
Aye.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweel.
Aye.
Bauman.
Aye.
Dieberg.
Aye.
Eberg.
Aye.
Serta.
Aye.
And Davis.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. Ordinances introduced, 473 to 475 to be referred. Matters laid over, 1239, Oro number 288-0506 by City Plan Commission recommending vacating the east-west unpaved alley located within the Fairview subdivision between North 27th Street and North 27th Place. Alderman Montemayor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I move to accept and file the RO and pass the ordinance.
There's a motion and a second. Under discussion? There being none, please call the roll.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor. Radke,
aye.
Sagali,
aye.
Stefan,
aye.
Susha,
aye.
Van Akron,
aye.
Vanderweel,
aye.
Bauman,
aye.
Dieberg,
aye.
Eberg,
aye.
Serta,
aye.
Davis,
aye.
And Graff.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. 1365, General Ordinance number 380506 by Alderman Susha, Vanderweel, Montemayor, Radke, and Meyer, relating to two-hour parking limits so as to create a two-hour time zone between 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. along the west side of the North 13th Street from the south curb line of Huron Avenue south to the existing no parking anytime zone remaining. Alderman Susha.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move that this ordinance be put upon its passage.
There's a motion, a second. Under discussion? There being none, please call the roll.
Manny.
Aye.
Meyer.
Aye.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stephan.
Aye.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweil.
Aye.
Bauman.
Aye.
Deberg.
Aye.
Eberg.
Aye.
Serta.
Aye.
Davis.
Aye.
Graf.
Aye.
And Kittleson.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. Other matters authorized by law, 1476 will go to Finance and the Library Board. 1477 will go to Public Works and Board of Parks and Forestry. 1478 will go to Public Works. 1479, an RO by the City Clerk submitting an application for a private well permit at 4145 South 16th Street. I'll ask for a motion to accept and file. Alderman.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Any discussion? Not. All those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. 1480 will lie over. 1481 by Alderman Stephan, authorizing the appropriate city official to execute an early construction agreement between the city, the Redevelopment Authority, and the Harborside Development and Entertainment LLC regarding permission to commence certain construction work on land to be leased from the city for certain facilities, including a harbor terminal building and a two-story shanty-style building. Alderman Stephan.
Thank you, Your Honor. I believe I need suspension of the rules.
Yes. There is a motion and a second. All those in favor state aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Please proceed.
Thank you. I would then move that the resolution be put upon its passage.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Under discussion?
Thank you, Your Honor. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. The group that was here last week, it just allows them to do a little preliminary work while we're still taking care of the final documents. The important thing, I think we had a question today and I wanted to point out on the second page, item number two, it just says commencement of construction under this letter is conditioned upon you first obtaining land use approval and architecture review board approval. So they will still have to go through normal procedures. That way it won't be any conflict there.
Okay. Thank you. Attorney McLean.
Thank you, Your Honor. One thing that did not get attached to this letter, if you look at paragraph 6, scope of work, 6A, it's on the second page. It says the nature and extent of the construction work to be performed in advance is subject to the advance written approval of the city. Permission is requested for the work described in Exhibit A attached. I didn't get anything from the developers until about quarter to five this afternoon, and I got an email. What they indicate is they're looking to start Harbor Terminal, the east building, and building one in the next couple of weeks. We'd be excavating, putting in the barrier, and pouring the foundation. We would not go further until final approval. So excavation, putting in the engineered barrier, and pouring a foundation, it would be the work described in Exhibit A attached, in other words, so for the council's information.
Thank you, Attorney McLean. Any more discussion? Not. Please call the roll.
Montemayor.
Aye.
Radke.
Aye.
Sagali.
Aye.
Stephan.
Aye.
Susha.
Aye.
Van Akron.
Aye.
Vanderweil.
Aye.
Bauman.
Aye.
Deberg.
Aye.
Eberg.
Aye.
Serta.
Aye.
Davis.
Aye.
Graf.
Aye.
Kittleson.
Aye.
Manny.
Aye.
And Meyer.
Aye.
16 ayes.
Motion carries. 1482 through 1486 will lie over. Other matters? Attorney McLean.
Thank you, Your Honor. 1487 is a communication from Mary Zarafanatis asking an accountability of the city's investment of $20 million plus in the Blue Harbor Resort and Conference Center.
And that will go to Finance.
1488 is a communication from Michael Warner responding to an article in the Sheboygan Press from Mr. Kepler dated October 9th.
And that will go to Committee of the Whole.
1489 is a communication from Dave Richter O'Connell, 2420 North 7th Street, stating his concern about the overall shape of the boulevard section of 7th Street from North Avenue down to Geely Avenue.
And that one will go to Public Protection and Safety and Public Works.
1490 is a claim from Betty Ann Steinprice for alleged damages to her property when city garbage men picked up her personal items just unloaded from her van as part of the garbage pickup.
And that one will go to Special Committee on Risk Management.
1491 is a resolution authorizing the sale of Lot 34, Northfield Meadows Subdivision.
And that one will go to City Planning.
1493 is a communication from James Boren, 1526 Knollcrest Drive, regarding the Milwaukee's Fair Share Program for Property Tax Exempt Organizations.
And that one will go to Finance.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor? Well, hold on. Alderman Sagali.
Thank you, Your Honor. What I would like to ask before this meeting ends is, could you please clarify that when 1461 came up and it was going to be referred, that you had said that I was not able to talk when I had talked to the city attorney and he said I could at least ask a question, and when I buzzed in, you said I couldn't? May I please ask, could you clarify that, please?
Which one are you talking about?
That is concerning the tourism promotion was 14-61, and I buzzed in, and then you had said that no, she can't talk. And all I wanted to do was ask a question.
When did I say that?
I think I signaled,
but I didn't know when he was.
Yeah, you signaled it, and he looked at you, and he says she can't talk.
I did not say she can't talk, okay? Let me see what Attorney McLean.
Well, my understanding was, I think the mayor thought you were buzzing in for discussion on the capital improvements program. That was the impression I got.
Okay. But that's when you buzzed in at the same time that I was reading the one with the capital improvements and said, which we'll talk later, or something like that, I think that's what I said.
Okay.
But I didn't say you can talk.
Okay. Well,
before we close, would you like to make a comment, Alderman Sagali?
I just wanted to ask if you could ask the finance. I would like to know how the monies that the Memorial Day Parade and Independence Day Parade are going to come up with the monies that you are taking away. I know they had upped it on their budget, and then you now have taken it away. And I also would like to know in what fund, the library fund, that you're going to decrease by $194,000. I'd like to know where that $194,000 is. You don't have to answer tonight. If you would, at your finance committee, the next one, just discuss it so that we would have some answers. I'd really like to know where that $194,000 is going to go if we decrease the library.
I can answer that.
Okay, hold on. We got buttons all over the place. Alderman Graf.
Thank you. $194,000. We, the Finance Committee, have no control over it. It was our recommendation to the Library Board. The Library Board is the one that has to come up with where the reductions will be made. There was one that was brought up during our meeting, and I don't remember what account that was, but at the meeting that we had, Sharon Winkle, the Library Director, had said, yes, she agrees. She thinks some of it can come out of there. But from what we were told at our Finance Committee meeting, it was not going to affect any positions, and there would be no reduction in hours. And at least that's what they were going to attempt to do, the library board, that is, because they're responsible for making the cuts in the various cost centers.
Okay. And do you know what their amount of maintenance of effort level is? Because I asked the city attorney, and he did not, and I wanted to know that if we cut them $194,000, is that going to put their membership in the federated library system?
Their maintenance effort will be enough. They'll have enough monies to cover the maintenance of effort. And Rich, what is the figure for maintenance of effort?
Mr. Gebhardt?
I don't have the calculation with me, but it is the average of the past 3 years' tax levies that is the maintenance of effort. And this will bring them at that level. They'll maintain that
194
level.
194 will bring them down to the maintenance of effort that they'd need. And the other monies, that was the additional sums that were asked for out of room tax money to be used for those four different things, the other amounts you asked about. And so we removed approximately $4,000 from additional requests and moved it back to what they had requested in 2005.
But you have the tourism.
And we moved those monies back into the tourism because that's from room tax. That's where it's supposed to be.
Okay.
Okay, Alderman, this is an issue that's coming up before finance. It's being referred to finance. I don't want to see committee meetings being conducted during our council meeting. That's why we have committees. It will be discussed by finance, so please be present, Alderman Segal, if you have some concerns. Otherwise, we're going to sit here all night and do our committee job during the council meeting. I don't know that that's the appropriate thing to do. Is that what you were going to say, Alderman Stefan? Sort of?
I was just going to help answer the question.
Okay.
Anyway.
Okay. All those in favor, adjourn?
Aye.
Any opposed? We stand adjourned.